Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to this, the 34th meeting of the Justice Committee in 2012? Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices completely, as the interview of the broadcasting system, even when they're switched to silent? No apologies have been received. Item 1. The committee is invited to agree whether to consider item 4 in private. Are we agreed?
Yes.
Item 2, police reform. This is an evidence session of police reform. The committee agreed that this session would focus mainly on the governance of policing and the operational independence of the Chief Constable under arrangements for a single national police force. I welcome our panel of witnesses. Andrew Laing, Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary, Chief Constable Stephen House, Police Service of Scotland, and Vic Emery, Chair of the Scottish Police Authority. And can I move members straight to questions? Colin?
Good morning. My question really relates to the relationship, obviously, that's been highlighted over the past couple of weeks between the Chair and the Chief Constable. Looking at the Holyrood magazine, Mr. Emery, you're quoted as saying that support staff should be subsumed within your chain of command. And, of course, on the following page, the Chief Constable is asking for the right to maintain authority over the rest of the of all staff within the police, which includes, of course, the support staff. Perhaps you give you this opportunity to try and define your roles as you see them. And is there any problem with the relationship? And if so, how is it going to be sorted, Mr. House?
Well, it's up to witnesses to actually come out first, Mr. Keir.
So which one? You, Mr. House, you want to speak
it was
first?
To
yes.
Both, it was to both.
I understand, but the chair actually picks.
I apologise.
I have to have something to do here. Mr. House.
Thank you, Chair. I think probably the most obvious question there, is there a problem between us? No, there isn't a problem between us. Far from it. We have a very positive working relationship, and you know we spend a lot of time in each other's company. Is there a 100% meeting of minds on the governance structure between the authority and the police service? No, there isn't 100% yet. There is a significant level of agreement covering the vast majority of functions, which the Chair and I have thrashed out in the last couple of weeks. There are still a couple of areas that we need to work through in terms of how exactly is that governance going to work. And I think, and obviously the Chair will answer for himself, but I think our view is some of that will only get worked out actually in the doing of it. This is a new act. It is a new situation for us. It's not simply a merged service under the old legislation. So there are changes to it, which, as always, take some getting used to. And there is some new thinking around as well, which is exactly why the Chair was brought in, I think, to provide some new thinking, and I'm perfectly content with that. There are a couple of areas where we still have to reach complete agreement on what the governance structure would look like, but on the vast majority we are agreed.
What are those two areas, please?
The two main areas are the direct relationship between the Director of HR and the Director of Finance and the Chief Constable vis-à-vis the authority, and exactly where that lies. And we're down to levels of practicalities in terms of talking about, well, where will the Director of Finance and where will the Director of HR actually work from on a daily basis, which may seem ridiculous, but actually isn't. It's a practicality as which signals, well, who are they actually working with on a day-to-day basis and who are they working for on a day-to-day
yes.
basis? And again, you know, the Chair will speak for himself, but my belief is our agreement is that on a day-to-day basis, the Director of Finance and HR will work at the police headquarters. And as I put it, in the same corridor as myself, and will come to my morning meetings and be part of my senior management team, but they will clearly have a responsibility and a relationship also to the police authority, because they will be the people who will be leading on the strategy around finance and HR, which is clearly, and again, the Act makes it quite clear, the role of the authority is not simply a scrutiny role, it's a provision and maintenance role as well. The budget is the police authorities. The support staff are the police authorities' employees. Therefore, they must have some sort of locus in relation to the director of HR and finance. So it's a slightly complex relationship, and that's why it's taken a bit of time to work out. There's a lot of other functions that we've agreed completely as to how is that going to work within the new setup. It's really only those two key posts that we are still thrashing through the detail on.
Could you spell out the other functions, please, for the committee?
I absolutely can, yes. So, for example, the Director of Information, Communication and Technology, ICT, the view we've taken, which I think is purely pragmatic, is that the SPSA has had direct control of that over the last 5 years, and what the police service hasn't had, frankly, you don't miss that much. ICT decisions tend to be fairly large-scale, strategic, big investments. And all I've asked for and has been completely agreed by the chair is that the police are an intelligent and powerful customer in relation to ICT requirements and have some way of feeding in to the ICT director what our needs are, both in the long term, the short and the medium term. But that the ICT director is not someone who I would need on my senior management team on a day-to-day basis, because I just don't think that's the dynamics of that. In relation to communications and media, I think we've again gone down a pragmatic view, which is these are two different entities in law. The police service and the police authority are two different legal entities with different responsibilities quite clearly laid down in legislation. And it's only therefore sensible that they will have different views on different things. For example, the police authority may not have or wish to take any view on something like alcohol pricing, minimum alcohol pricing, or possession of knife and penalties for possession of knives. The Chief Constable and the police service may well want to take a position on that. So we believe it's entirely appropriate, because there will be areas that the authority will want to take a view on that the service will be silent on, that the ICT role, that the communications role is one that is, each has their own unit for that, to express differences of different opinions. The same is true with legal, I think, as well. The same argument follows. Different legal entities and legal positions, therefore needing different legal advice. And in addition, I, as the Chief Constable, will need fairly operational legal advice on such things as Public Order Act provisions, Licensing Act provisions, discipline regulations, specialisms, really, which you wouldn't need to have if you were working for the police authority. So we see two different legal units working to each of the two bodies on that one. There are some areas, again, like audit, where we have a view that, from an ethical point of view, audit should come nowhere near the line management of the Chief Constable. Audit is effectively there to make sure that we're spending public money wisely and efficiently. That's the role of the authority to oversee. So the audit function should report directly into the police authority and completely bypass the Chief Constable, which at the moment is not the case. Technically speaking, in forces at the moment, audit comes under Chief Constables. It's really quite messy and feels ethically far more appropriate that they report direct to the police authority. Procurement is another area where, in deference to the fact that the Act speaks very clearly that the role of the authority is a provisioning and a maintaining role as well as a scrutiny role, it seems to make sense that procurement is something which the authority takes care of directly. And may choose to do so in a variety of different ways. And again, all that we've asked and it's been agreed is that we are intelligent customers, so that we can say, here are the specifications of the kind of vehicle we need for motorway patrol work. We're not going to say which vehicle it is, we're going to say what the specifications are. Here's a specification that we may need for firearms officers, for sidearms, for firearms. Here are the specifications we would like for uniforms. But it's up to the authority to then take that, go away and negotiate contracts with the private sector to provide those sort of equipment. So, I mean, that's probably the vast majority of the functions that we're discussing. And as I say, on all those, we don't have an issue. Where we're still debating, and it's a debate, is HR and finance.
That's very helpful. Mr. Emery.
I agree with Steve, basically. We're focused at the moment on making sure that the people of Scotland have the very best police force they can for the available funds. And our focus has been working together. In fact, we spend a lot of time together. And between October and Christmas, we will have achieved the appointment of all of the DCCs, all of the ACCs. We will have agreed a voluntary redundancy scheme. We have 12 members of the authority in place. And we are already beginning to consult on the strategic priorities. So our focus has been on making sure that we're ready for day one. And Steve and I get along very well progressing that agenda.
Could I, just in a follow-up then, the two areas that you've been talking about that are still under debate, how far have you got with resolving this debate? When could we expect a resolution?
We have said publicly that we will have all of the structures in place before the end of this year. Mm-hmm. We have a joint meeting in the beginning of December, I think it's the 4th or 5th, where we will debate those together with the board, because this is not a negotiation between Steve and myself. It is an agreement between the Police Service of Scotland and the SPA, and there are 12 other board members that I have to bring along with me, and that meeting will take place, I think, on the 4th or 5th of December.
Okay. Thank
you.
Followed by John, Alison and Rod.
If I can ask Mr. Emery, you would hear the outline that Mr. House has given about the areas still under debate. Could you share with us your view of how the authority would like that to play out?
I think that, to be honest, that's best left until we have an agreement with the Chief Constable. I think we're basically on the same page with regard to having a federated-type model or a matrix model. Some people call it a matrix model. And in that respect, If you follow the money, as it were, if you look at the finance side, the money comes into the SPA. The SPA is the accountable authority for that money. That money then gets separated into its various components, for which each head of those components are responsible for delivering the services within that budget. Clearly, a big chunk of that will be for the Police Service of Scotland. And so they will have an agreed budget, and once that's agreed, they will be asked to deliver against that budget. And they will have, as Steve has already said, they will have a chief financial officer, a finance director, a head of finance, don't mind what we call it, but they will have a head finance person who is accountable to the chief constable and a part of the chief constable's team for delivering the services within that budget. As I'll go back to my opening remark, our main objective here is to give the people of Scotland the very best police services, but within the budget that's available.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that governance is one of these salty issues that people find difficult to get their heads around and realise the significance of it. I think certainly from my own point of view, it's important that we understand who leads the Police Service of Scotland, who's responsible for it, who's in charge of it, and who will call that person to account and ensure appropriate governance. That's really the nub of the issue that we're dealing with here. And if I can put it in a very different set of circumstances, I read the Telegraph at the weekend, and there was a series of quotes there in an article not related to the police service. And it started, "So who's responsible for this shambles? The minister lumbered the organisation with a new governance system that everybody said wouldn't work. Instead, she and presumably civil servants introduced the present system in spite of advice from people who know what is needed. And a disaster was waiting to happen, and that's what we've seen in recent weeks." And that came from Greg Dyke speaking about the BBC and the mess they found themselves in. And he said the problem was no one was quite sure who was in charge. Was it the chairman or the director general? Mm. And I think that really concentrates the mind on what we're discussing here. We've got a real chance to get this right. And I think from my own point of view, I can't speak for anybody else in the committee, I want to be sure you have all the sharpness required to call the Chief Constable to account, to discipline that person if it's necessary, and bring forward whatever's required to put things right. But I also would like to go home at night knowing that if things go wrong within the service, then the Chief Constable is the person we focus on. And that person is then responsible for reporting to you and explaining things. Am I on the right page there in terms of where you want to take this?
I don't think there's any difference between what you've said and what Steve or I have said this morning.
Mr. House?
Yeah, I don't have any difficulty with what you said either. I'm not trying to change the subject here, but I mean, I'm not surprised we're here, frankly. This is new legislation, two new organisations. I would have been amazed if it had all gone completely and utterly smoothly, and if it had, it would probably have been wrong. At some point in my selection process or at some media, I was asked, is there not a danger here of central control and domination of the police by a powerful individual, and I think they had in mind a senior politician, simply bullying the Chief Constable into doing what the Chief Constable didn't want to do but felt they had no choice? I think what you're seeing here is that, frankly, the governance in macro terms and the legislation is probably working, because we are struggling with this. A couple of areas of a much wider canvas, the canvas is agreed, really, a couple of key areas, we're struggling with it. And we're not hiding that strong. We're not going to the press to talk about it, but we are talking to other people. Look, we've got an issue here. And frankly, the way I see it as a positive is that we're here now and you're trying to help us out with this issue and to provide some clarity and make sure you have clarity that you need for Parliament and for the public. And we want that clarity too. We are working our way through this. But I'm certainly not going to hide the fact that we do have slight differences of opinion and we want to see how this works out. And frankly, you know, the alternative is one of us caves into the other and says, well, that's fine, then we'll just do what you want. Well, that, I don't think, is appropriate to the public sector here. It's a public service, and it's a hugely important public service in terms of personal freedom and public freedoms in Scotland. So it has to be got right. Mm. The fact that it's not happened instantly and smoothly doesn't bother me that much, to be honest. I know some people take a view of, oh, this is spreading fear and despondency. My view is if it goes on a lot longer, it starts to become negative. But actually, you know, I don't think it's been happening for that long, and you've heard the chairman say it. We're very close to, right, what's this actually going to look like in terms of HR and finance on a day-to-day basis? And I also have to flag up to you here, and I hope I'm not being presumptuous, we think this is the governance structure that will work, and if after a couple of months we sit down and review it and say, actually, that's not quite working, then we'll probably need to try and make some changes to it. It's really important stuff, and if we just swept it under the carpet and said, oh, everything's fine, I think that would be the wrong approach, and we're clearly not doing that. But we are, I think, maturely saying, yeah, there are some issues between us, but they're not huge fractures. They are differences of experience, if anything else, bringing different experiences to bear on this. But going back to what you said, I sign up entirely. You need clarity. The public needs clarity on what is the relationship here. The relationship is, as far as I'm concerned, I'm in charge of operational policing across Scotland. Not operational police, but operational policing across Scotland. Mm-hmm. And I am completely accountable to the chair of the authority and the authority for the execution of that and for the spending of the budget and the use of all the resources. I don't have any problem in my mind about the accountability.
Mr. Laing has listened to our conversation thus far, and you've previously reported as HMI on current setups across forces. Would there be any comments you would want to give in terms of what you've heard and the lessons you've learned in the past?
Absolutely. We've recently produced and published the Best Value Overview report. That's a statement reflecting back on 3 years' worth of study jointly with HMICS and Audit Scotland. It kind of takes a reflection of a moment in time, but one of the things it does emphasise is the need for governance and accountability in policing in Scotland to be strengthened significantly. That level of submission was made in evidence to this committee during the consultation period by HMICS, and I think what developed in the Act was a framework that would allow for far better governance, scrutiny and accountability as we move forward. Probably reflecting on the Chief Constable's comments, I think what we're going through at the moment is actually healthy and it's necessary. We've got a new Act, we've got new functions, we've got new posts, we've got new people, and we've got new relationships being developed, and there was always going to be some debate and discussion round about where the boundaries lie, and I don't think it'll end in December or January. I think that healthy debate and discussion will go on at a lower level over the period ahead, and as we continue to see how this balances out. The reality for me in listening to the discussion is that there needs to be balance in any system, and that's hugely important here, and it's where the balance is set rather than the actual the extremes of it. Segregation of decision-making in an operational sense from the control of resource and finance reduces flexibility, and policing needs to be flexible and needs to be able to respond. As we move forward, any notion that significant direction and control for that operational aspect, and Steve's very clearly segregated out the strategic bit from the quick time bit, but any notion that direction and control is being exercised by the authority, which may be legitimate in terms of the Act, reduces its ability to provide that segregation for governance and accountability. In other words, it can't hold itself to account. The consequence of that is that there will be more external governance and scrutiny, and that's probably not what's intended. So as we see this moving forward, and as we see things like the scheme of delegation, scheme of administration, the financial memorandum starting to be developed to say, here is how the balance exists, that will determine the role and the nature of the involvement of HMI, of the Auditor General. But from what I'm hearing today, and from what I've heard over the period, I think we're getting closer and closer to a well-balanced system, to one that has been commonly agreed or will be commonly agreed by the Board and the Chief Constable, and one which should give us a great deal of confidence that the investment in the new authority, the investment in the professionalism of it, the competence that we criticised which existed within previous authorities, that capacity that comes by way of support to it, leads us to a position where we should have good and strong governance and accountability, and we should have power vested in the Chief Constable to exercise his responsibility for operational policing in a day-to-day manner, and I guess in turn should allow us and you to go home at night and rest safely in the knowledge that policing is being well catered for.
Can I just come back on?
I haven't quite. I mean, it sounds as if Emily Garden's growing lovely. We've just got to wait a little and it'll all flourish. But I still don't understand, at the end of the day, if something goes very wrong with policing that may be connected to resources, let's say, the wrong kind of equipment or something that the SPA is in charge of, who at the end of the day is responsible? Who would the public will say, that's the person to blame? That's where the blame rests. I'm not clear about that yet. Because I know it's fuzzy between what's operational and what's not operational. I've learned that much. So you say we can all go and be happy and content and it'll all be okay, but is that right?
I think what I'm saying is as it develops, we'll get much more clarity about where those defined lines are. If I could use two extreme examples, if something catastrophically went wrong with an inquiry that the police were taking forward, my view would be, and my understanding as to the way things are developing, are that that would fall fairly and squarely on the shoulders of the Chief Constable to be held to account initially by a Scottish Police Authority, but by wider scrutiny groups if necessary. If it was a fundamental failing in the way that the overall finance of policing was being managed, i.e. a failure to make the overall savings, the benefits that were required, then that's a matter for the authority who are singularly responsible for the finance.
But what if it was something that had been cut by the SPA, some financial decision that was made by them that then meant that something down the line went wrong with the policing? It's not us, it meets the grey areas that matter. It's not the easy peasy ones.
No. And
so who's responsible there?
But I mean, that would be a matter for, I guess, some level of audit, some level of scrutiny externally to try and make that determination. But it's no different, I guess, from where we are at the moment. And I would think and hope that the financial memorandums, the scheme of administration, the scheme of delegation will set that out relatively clearly, but we get back into the muddy territory that we've always been in. And if you recall in the run-up to the Act, I made a fairly strong plea that we get a very clear or the clearest possible determination on what I determined as being operational independence, what John McNeill said was operational responsibility, the Act hasn't covered that grey area, so it still exists in the middle.
Graham?
Yes. I think, in fairness, just to deal with the Act part of it, I think, in fairness, it would be very difficult to write every relationship into the Act and then leave it to two professional people to deal with, because then you don't have any professional responsibility. You just tick the boxes thereafter. I mean, I think the conveners touched on one of the key points. If there's a fudge and if there's an overlap in responsibilities, we end up no one being responsible. And I think that from my own viewpoint, and this is for Mr. Emery, when he spoke on the 29th of October, he indicated that the authority had very wide-ranging set of responsibilities in the running of policing, indicated that he equated the chief constable to a chief operations officer, and then reflected that the vision's not yet final, it's for the authority to develop the clarity. And I think that's where and I do accept that this is a healthy process, that we get to where we want to be only by discussion, but I'd also suggest to all three of you, this committee has a right to know what those discussions are and to be part of it, and the public are entitled to know what's being said in their name. And it's not for the three of you to sort it out in a dark room and just present it to us on the 1st of April and say, get on with it. It's too important for that kind of outcome. So I think it's about the clarity of your responsibilities in calling this man to account and doing it very effectively. That's what we want, because I think HMI reports over the years have indicated the problem with the current structure wasn't so much about the management of policing. The problem was very much about the authorities calling them to account and producing that rigour to make it better and better each year. So it's trying to deal with this issue of, can we rid ourselves of as much fog in this relationship as possible?
Mr. Emery.
I think you should take comfort from the fact that we are going through this debate at the moment, because we have to get it right from the beginning, and therefore I have no doubt in my mind that I hold Steve responsible for the policing of Scotland. And all of that entails. And I think, well, in fact, I know he accepts that responsibility. And at the end of the day...
Do you feel you're running the police?
No, I'm not running the police. So I'm running the SPA. And the SPA provides services to the police to enable them to do the job. They also provide the finances to allow them to do the job.
Indeed.
And a part of this process is to agree exactly what finances are required, what savings and how those savings will be manifested, so that there is no compromise of the policing. I go back to the point I've made a couple of times. We are here to make sure the people of Scotland get the very best service they can at an affordable price.
Yes,
that's what we're here to do. And once we agree that, then Mr. House can speak for himself, but he is then responsible for delivering that. So if something went wrong from a policing point of view, then the first port of call would be Mr. House. And the SPA would actually hold Mr. House accountable for that.
So who would hold you to account if it was a failure of the services you provided to the police that caused the failure of the policing, if we go right up the chain, to cause and effect? Who would hold the SPA to account?
I'm responsible to you and Parliament for the delivery of the SPA's responsibilities and the Police Service of Scotland. That's what the Act requires me to do. The Act anticipates that some services will be delivered to the police by the SPA.
I'll let others come into what services actually says you are mandated to actually provide.
Well, we could deal with it now.
There's
if
a
you
lot.
Wish.
Well, yes, if you wish, because there's a lot of me, and there's shalls, and there's a big difference. So.
And that is why I will repeat what I said earlier, which is you should be comforted by the fact that we're going through that debate now to get it right.
Over the me's.
Pardon?
Over the me part, me that's the parts in the section that deal with me provide.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, Mr. House.
Yeah, thanks. I just wanted to try and sort of square off discussion that, Mr. Pearson raised, which was he asked Vic, "Who's is he running the police?" And he said, "No, he's running the SPA." Let's be clear. I'm leading the police. I don't believe there's any doubt about that in anyone's mind. There will always be the grey areas of if something goes wrong, who's to blame for this?
Yes.
And if it's an investigation that goes seriously awry, then clearly the police have got that wrong. There may be reasons why they've got it wrong. It may be that their training wasn't adequate because money wasn't available because of the budget, or overtime wasn't available, or they had the wrong equipment, or the computer system didn't work the way it should do. And that has to be looked at, and there are plenty of people to do that, including yourselves and Parliament and the media, et cetera, as well as HMI. But in terms of the role and distinction, I don't think there's any issues between Vic and I on that at all. I haven't detected any ambition from him to be operationally controlling any police issues, and I think we've gone through fairly clearly a number of areas where we agree there's a split of provision, which we've already agreed on.
Mr. Laing.
I think they're just coming on one point. You asked the question, who holds the Scottish Police Authority to account? They're clearly responsible and accountable to Parliament, but HMIC, and picking up on a point that Mr. Pearson made when he said we don't want to hear the three of us doing it in a darkened room and coming out, I've got to make a clear distinction. HMIC is not part of the Scottish Police Authority or the
so
Police
you're
Service.
Not in a darkened room with these two gentlemen.
It's a very lit up room, but it's
they're
it's
alone
one that's
in
alone.
Their darkened room, right?
So we exercise that independence, and whilst my role here is to absolutely try and encourage the debate and try and add flavour from our experience previously and from the learning we've had, it would be my responsibility, along with Auditor General, to provide reports to Parliament to say, here's where we think it is.
I'll let somebody in. Can we just your last game, but
of course.
Then I must let others in.
It's just to clear the point. I'm grateful for the clarity that HMI has brought to it. And I raise the issues not to have a go at you as convener, but it's a language that's used in a very key moment in indicating the running of policing, the notion of a chief constable being the chief operating officer, and this idea of how the vision is developed. And I just want to put it on record, you've now said, no, that's not the case, and we've now got clarity in that, and it helps the general public understand where we stand with it. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Emery.
Can I just add a point to Andrew Lang's? Not only does the HMIC scrutinise what we do and audit us, but so do Audit Scotland. Mm. It's not simply HMIC.
Can I just clarify, you did say, I think earlier, I think both of you said that Steve House and Vic Emery, that while these two really substantial areas are under some discussion about where the Directorate of Finance and HR will be located and therefore answerable to, you didn't see these things fixed in stone in that if things didn't work out, then we're not looking at something that's, you know, it might be final when we're launching in April, but after that, if it doesn't work out like that, there's room for tweaking.
Yes, there is room for tweaking. And again, Steve and I have had a discussion about the best way forward and testing that way forward for review if necessary. The Act is prescriptive in some areas and permissive in others, and therefore we need to get the best solution going forward. Best to take time to do that properly rather than rush into it.
I'll take John, then Alison, please.
Thank you, Convener. It's a question for Mr. Emery and Mr. House, and it's following up on a point that Graeme Pearson made there about the use of language and how important that is. If I noted you correctly, Mr. Emery, you said I have to get it right from the beginning. If I noted you correctly, at one point, Mr. House, you talked about caving in and not being seen to cave in. So my question to both of you is, have you received legal advice in respect of your role? From whom did you receive it? At whose behest did you request it? What was that advice? And did you use the same person?
Your starter for 10.
Yes, my very first thing that I did was to come in, be appointed, and as you would do, I said, what am I here to do? The first document I look at is the Act, because that describes what the SPA is here to do. I then take legal advice on the Act to say, what is the art of the possible here? What do we need to do? What does this Act say we have to do? So I did take legal advice on that. I then went to the Scottish Government with that advice and I said, is this your intent? What did you intend this Act to do? Because this is what the legal advice says that the Act is about. And they basically confirmed that the legal advice was correct. So, yes, I did get legal advice. I don't know the name of the law firm. I can get that for you if you. I can follow that through and give you that.
And who paid for that?
That was paid for by the SPA.
And who sanctioned that?
I did.
You sanctioned your own legal advice?
Yes.
Right. Okay. And if some future employee had some employment law issues, you would sanction them getting commercial legal advice about their.
No, but I am responsible for the SPA and therefore discharging the Act. Therefore, I got legal advice on what the Act enables me to do. If I was an employer, I would get outside legal advice on any employment issue that I had, just the same as the employee would take their own legal advice.
And who do you envisage you're an employee of?
I am an employee of the SPA.
Can I ask if we may see that legal advice?
I've already had a request from Graham Pearson as an individual for that, and I have said that that is legally privileged, that I am quite happy to provide that, but on a holistic basis, so I wouldn't want the legal advice that I got taken out of context, and therefore, if there's legal advice available to other parties in this Act, then I'm happy to share it along with those other that other legal advice.
And Chris, you actually said basically confirmed, so that's the difficult word, basically.
Well, it confirms that some things are prescriptive and some things are permissive.
Well, we can see that from the Act, may and shall. One's mandatory and the other isn't,
yes,
discretionary.
But it the Act is general in some areas and not in others, and therefore we needed that.
If perhaps we'll pursue, to ask Mr. House if you've got legal advice as well.
Yes, indeed. Thank you, Convener.
And then Mr. House, if you have, can we see that? Then we can see both lots of legal advice.
I did get legal advice. I did it after a conversation with one of the Strathclyde, well, in fact, the Strathclyde lead lawyer, because he alerted me to his concerns about the Act in a specific area, and that area was... He didn't believe that the Act allowed the authority to delegate to me control over support staff, which is clearly sort of a bit of a gobsmacking major problem with legislation, as far as I was concerned. And I asked him to clarify that legal advice, and he went to a outside lawyer with expertise in the area, whose name I don't know. And he provided written legal advice. Since then, a
commercial lawyer.
Yes.
Who do you envisage pays that bill?
The individual lawyer works for Strathclyde Police. Therefore, they will pay that, because at the moment I have no employees, and Strathclyde Police Authority will come out of Strathclyde Police Authority's budget.
Can I ask you the same question? And there's a range of new posts being developed. Will the public purse pay for people to interpret their job descriptions and the like?
Yeah, I just have to come back to you on that, because I'm not interested in my job description. What I'm interested in is what does the Act allow me to do, and is it workable in terms of leading the police service? So this wasn't
I'm
private.
I'm confused by neither if you would go to, for instance, Scottish Government officials.
Well, in fact, the reality of the problem is Scottish Government officials that wrote the Act.
Yes.
So if I went back, if
well,
I went
so
to them and said,
to know what perhaps they intended.
Well, can I finish my answer?
Excuse me, I'm kind of losing the thread here a little bit. I want to get back to the legal advice. I have to say, with respect to John, I'm not so bothered about that, but whether we can see it.
You can see the legal advice I have. I have no issue with that.
Mr. House, we can see your legal advice, and Mr. Emery, we can see your legal advice now.
Yes, and I assume that you'll get the Scottish Government to give you legal advice, their legal advice too.
Well, no. The answer to that is probably no. Governments do not give their legal advice in principle, and this has happened in the last 13 years. But I think, in fairness, we're entitled to see your legal advice, the two of you. You're the two we are concerned about here and what you represent. So can I take it? You haven't had legal advice as well, have you, Mr. Laing? We all...
Absolutely
you've had
not.
Legal advice as well?
No, I'm independent.
Good, good. So before you come in, can this committee see the legal advice from both of you?
You can certainly see my legal advice. I have no issue with that. But can I just finish my point, please? Because
I just want to finish this before you do. Well, Mr. Emery, will you let us see your legal advice?
Yes, I will.
That's it.
In concert with all the other legal advice that is available.
Now, you're not going to get Scottish Government's legal advice. End of
story.
They
don't have any, then there is none to see, is there?
They don't say whether or not they've taken it or whether they will let you see it. What I'm saying is a very fair offer from Mr. House to see his legal advice, and it would be therefore, I thought, fair for you to let us see your legal advice.
Yeah, and I'm quite happy to do that in a holistic way.
Well, not going back through that. You take the answer as no.
The answer is yes, in a holistic way.
What does that mean?
It means all the legal advice that is available. And if there isn't any available from the Scottish Government, then it can't be put forward, can it?
The government will not say whether or not it has taken. Everything that goes through, every bill that appears, has been legalised in that sense. Right? So if that's sufficient, that is the case in here. It wouldn't be endorsed. We wouldn't have the presiding officer giving it a certificate. So it's been through that. Can we accept that? And perhaps now, without that, just say, can we see your legal advice?
Yes, you can. I will forward it to you as chair.
If you forward it to me, Mr. Emery, it is shared with the committee.
Yeah,
I chair the
fine.
Committee.
That's fine.
So we're going to have your legal advice and Mr. House's legal advice, full stop. Yeah. Yes. Thank you very much. And that can be done soon. Thank you very much. Before the next meeting, I hope within 7 days. That's grand. Now, I'm so sorry to get... I just wanted to resolve that because we're going round and about. Mr. House, you wanted to finish something. I rudely interrupted you there, Mr. Laing. You want to come in and you've not had legal advice, which is great. Now, Mr. House.
Thank you. I don't want to go back to whether government legal advice exists or not, but nonetheless, whether it does... The government and certainly civil servants have an opinion on the interpretation of the Act. And if you don't get a civil servant's opinion on the Act and what it allows and does not allow, I don't think you'll see the complete picture because, frankly, you won't. The legal advice I was given makes no sense whatsoever unless you read it in terms of how has the Act been interpreted by civil servants. And it's that, therefore, that's the complete picture. Now, I'm quite sure the civil servants would, if you asked them, be prepared to come forward and tell you how they interpret the Act and believe it should be interpreted.
We have, Mr. House, the policy memorandum. We also have stage three. We have the explanatory notes. We have stage three debate, at which the Cabinet Secretary is tested and has to say general things about it. So I think that's where we'll leave that for the time being. And Mr. Laing, then I'll take you back in, John.
It's probably been covered by Mr. House. And getting access to legal advice, I have to bear in mind that this is an Act which has gone through and this is an external interpretation of a piece of written legislation. The real importance for me is, and my involvement in this has been fairly extensive in that I've sat on all of the programme groups, project boards, I've been at a variety of committees giving evidence and looking at it from an impartial and independent perspective. The question really centres on what was the intent of the Act when written, and that legal advice will not give you the intent, which is the point that's been made. I mean, if I was to pursue it to a kind of defined point, if the intent of the Act had been to ensure that the Scottish Police Authority took responsibility for all personnel and resource that were not police officers, I don't think it would simply have prescribed the Forensic Science Services as being a bespoke part. And so I think when we come back into the intent and my reading of the intention of the Act has been written in a very prescriptive way, but that was not the intent. So the legal advice will give you an interpretation of what the prescription is, but not what lay behind it.
No, but we do know the difference between mandatory and discretionary in the committee. So, John?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'd also like to ask the panel about ICT, and in particular the relationship between the authority, the Chief Constable, with regard to a historic ICT project in Scotland, which I understand was called Platform, And I've heard various figures quoted in relation of this from between several million to up to £14 million, and the system is obsolete. I may be wrong, Mr. Laing, I know you and I have previously discussed this, but the point of principle is, how will the scheme of delegation, or will there be mechanisms in place to prevent a repetition of that gross waste of public money?
If I can make just a very short offering to ensure that the committee are aware, HMIC are currently building up terms of reference jointly with Audit Scotland to go back and review the process of platform. The findings will come out at a point during next year, just so you're aware that there is an interest there independently.
Right. I've got... nobody else indicated they wanted to... Nobody else indicated they wanted to come in. Beg your pardon, Mr. House.
My apologies, I'm not quite sure. The mechanism of speaking on it.
Just a glance at me and I should... Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, my understanding of platform is relatively arm's length, to be honest. It was already in existence when I think it's been around for a number of years. The intent behind it, I think, was correct, which was to provide a single way of looking at performance across 8 Scottish police services. Of course, that's now redundant in itself, in that there will be one Scottish Police Service, which will have its own ICT strategy, and that will be another benefit, is it will be easier to do. In terms of the governance, I go back to what I suggested at the start of this, which is, historically, police and indeed the whole public sector have not been very intelligent customers around ICT, don't understand how it works. So I'm all in favour of an introduction of a far more business-like approach to the identification and acquisition and installation and running of ICT projects. I think actually ACPOS has made major steps forward in the last few years to improve how it goes about doing this. And I won't make any comment on platform, but I think we're far more the intelligent customer now than we used to be. And that's partly to do with the fact that the SPSA now exists. And effectively the process works in that we decide we have a need for something in the ICT field, and we then discuss it with SPSA and in future, I think, with SPA staff and explain what our business need is. They then decide how that business need is best met. And I think that's the efficient and effective way of going about it. They then decide whether they're going to build it themselves, they're going to buy an off-the-shelf product, or whether they're going to commission a private sector company to build a specific product for use by the police. It's a fairly well-tried and tested methodology, and it's one that I've no doubt we will be embracing. I think that's why we've said earlier the ICT director is slightly more arm's length, because you don't make that sort of decision on a daily basis. You do it on the basis of a business case that we would take forward and eventually would go in front of the police authority for them to agree and to support. So I think the future looks better, and I'm quite clear that the chair will be holding us to account to make sure we're intelligent customers, and everybody else will be holding the authority to account to make sure that they provide the needs of the police service.
That seems to be settled. You've settled about ICT, haven't you? That seems to be something resolved. Yes, that's it. Fine. I'm now moving on to... That's sorted. We'll tick that one off. Alison, followed by Rod, then Sandra, please.
Questions I might come back to later, but I still need to pursue the clarity that
yes,
as yet doesn't exist round about HR and finance and issues like that. Mr. Emery, you said you spent a lot of time in Mr. House's company. What other company are you keeping? Who else?
Relevant to this discussion.
Who else are you spending a lot of time with? Is it the civil servants? Is it the minister?
I hardly see the minister. I have a regular slot with the minister, and I fulfilled that slot. So I've seen him since we've last met, I think, once, with Steve House, actually. So we've met once. The rest of the time I'm spending with the board. I spend a lot of time with the newly appointed board, and actually getting them up to speed on what their legislative liabilities and responsibilities are. We've met 4 times, I think. There's a lot of preparation to do that. I'm in the process of meeting all of the conveners of the current police forces to ensure that we have a sensible handover transition plans between the Police Service of Scotland and the existing forces. And I spend time with the Chief Constable, of course.
What about the civil servants?
I spend less time with them. I at the beginning of the period, I spent a lot of time with the civil servants, but that's less and less now because they are slowly handing over that mandate to the SPA.
Yeah, I mean, we've heard this morning that there's concern around interpretation of the legislation and the intent of the legislation, and that, I think, goes to the heart of the tensions that exist at the moment, and I would like absolute clarity around that. So you have taken, put a lot of your weight of your consideration on what the civil servants have told you is their how they want the Act to be interpreted, is that right?
Yeah, they put the Act through Parliament. They were the ones that did the Act. I needed to understand what their intent was in doing that. And I then used that to inform the newly appointed board of the SPA as to what their mandate was and what the liabilities that they have in doing so.
Yeah, that I think is quite concerning, and I think goes to the heart of where the problem is. The bill obviously instructs you to do things. You have to do some things. You would clearly like to do a lot of other things. Have you come into this job with a kind of reforming zeal, or do you want to provide the best police service going forward without any changes and, you know, a seamless transition?
Well, I think you've covered quite a few different things in that statement. I would like a seamless transition. I've already explained to you that I have had meetings with some conveners, not all, but I intend to do that in the next little while to make sure we have a seamless transition. I pick up the Act as my document for setting up the SPA, and that is the document. So I'm surprised that you would be concerned that I use the Act as my primary document moving forward, and that is the document used to inform the board of their responsibilities.
Not that you should use the Act, but that you should use the Act in conjunction with some extra advice about what was really intended by the Act.
No, you do that because you needed to understand what the intent of the Act was, because it is prescriptive and permissive in different areas. So we needed to understand where we're going. The fact is that the budget belongs to the SPA, and they then split up that budget into the various component parts, the biggest chunk of which goes to the Police Service of Scotland. And there is an agreement between the Chief Constable and the SPA, its 12 board members, to ensure that that budget is sufficient to do the reforming and the policing of Scotland. That is what we're doing at the moment. And we're putting the structures in place to ensure that there's proper governance and proper accountability.
If I might, you're clearly trying to develop structures, and much of the early questioning was around about what if something goes catastrophically wrong. What I would like to know is how we provide the best police service if the police constable doesn't have operational responsibility for the whole package. And I would like to hear from the Chief Constable. We saw in the audit report, which was just published this month, that Mr. Laing referred to, that more efficient and effective use of resources across the police work.
Qualify whole package. What you mean by that? What's concerning you? Is it the HR?
HR and finance are the areas that concern me.
So is your question that the Chief Constable should be...
Well, I want to know if the Chief Constable feels that if he doesn't have direct responsibility for those functions, can he actually have a properly balanced and integrated workforce?
Thank you. Mr. House.
Well, thanks for that. I think I can be pretty simple in my answer. I absolutely believe it's essential that I have day-to-day control of HR and finance functions within the police service to provide the police service for the public of Scotland. I think the Act actually says that, because it says I have direction and control of the police service. It doesn't say police constables. And if it meant police constables, it would say police constables. It says police service. We are a mixed service of police officers and support staff. There's 6,000 support staff and 17,500 police officers. Direction and control of both of those arms of the organisation is absolutely essential to provide policing for Scotland. I'm interested in the day-to-day control, and also I'm interested in a sizable say in the strategic direction of how that develops. I don't expect to have a final decision unaided on the strategic direction, because I think that's something which should go in the right format to a board. So, for example, if we decided to change the recruiting model for police officers in Scotland to a different way of doing it, something more like the NHS does, then I would expect to work that up in concert with my director of HR and take that to the police authority for their discussion, and if they agreed with it, we would put that into practice.
So I think it's so director of HR, director of finance, yours.
Yes.
Yes, and the SPA, to use your expression, would be the intelligent customer. I'm being naughty, but in the sense of the balance would shift.
Yeah. I think there's a shift of balance, but not missing the fact that within the framework stays the same, which is that the budget is the SPA's, not mine, and all the employees are the SPA's, not mine, but they effectively loan them to me. To do the day-to-day running of the police service. But I need the direction and control of those people as much as I need it of constables in uniform.
You are their boss. Yes. If I just get finance...
Well, but you need more than that, surely. You need also an involvement in the shape of that particular resource.
Yes, and that's work that's ongoing at the moment. And builds into the budget debate as well. And we've heard about voluntary redundancies, but we are... deep in the middle in police reform at Tully Allen of designing and developing HR and finance structures, numbers of staff, where they will work, what their jobs will be across Scotland. Now, I believe that I have to have the decision on that because, frankly, I'm designing the machine to work for me on a day-to-day basis. But that doesn't mean to say that the police authority doesn't get to say, well, actually, we think that's... you've been overly dramatic in your cuts there, you need extra people in that unit, or actually we think you can take more out of the management costs there. That's entirely an appropriate discussion to be had. But there's no point, I don't think, in me saying I have direction and control of HR and finance if I have to take what I'm given.
Exactly.
I have to have a say in that.
Yeah.
But just to be clear, this is not us fighting battles here. There's no suggestion from the chair that I take what I'm given at the moment. We are doing that design, and I expect to present that to the board and for the board to say yes or no to that sort of structure.
No, I agree. The police staff will always be employed by the SPA. But before they become police staff, they're staff. And when they get allocated to the Police Service of Scotland, they become police staff. And when that happens, they come under the direction and control of the Chief Constable.
Just looking at Section 21(3) of the Act, that's where some of the mischief is, I think, in that it states police staff and police cadets are, in the carrying out of their functions, subject to direction and control of and may be dismissed by the Chief Constable. But you're saying... you've got another role in here, the SPA.
No, I'm not saying that at all.
With direction and control of the policing, but...
No, the policing...
I understand that.
In terms of the people that do the policing, they are police constables and police staff. And they are under the direction and control of the Chief Constable.
Can I just ask for clarifying of police staff from Mr. House, and then I'll let you in,
Julie. Police officers are sworn constables. We all hold the rank of constable, despite whatever our administrative rank is. That's police officers. Police staff is, you could, police staff, stroke, support staff,
that's
stroke, civilians.
At.
Police staff are non-sworn constables.
That's what I'm getting at, the distinction. Is
They're not police officers. Yeah. They don't enforce the law of the land. They are there to assist us. So there are 17,500 cops and about 6,000 support staff, civilians, police staff, different names for the same thing.
That's where, for me, the confusion arises in that HR, I think, are saying if you were director of HR was under the SPA, police staff would be under your remit. Is that correct? That's what that would do.
Yes, absolutely correct.
You would be responsible for carrying out the function, direction, control, and dismissal.
I think part of the problem.
That's the problem.
Well, I think part of the problem, and I'm not a lawyer, but police officers are not by definition employees. So they are not. Police officers are not employed by the SPA.
No, this is police staff.
Yes, so I'm trying to make the distinction. Uh-huh. Police staff are employees and are employed by the SPA, and therefore the chair and the board of the SPA are their employers. Effectively, the board loan the police staff to the chief constable on a day-to-day basis, and I direct and control them to provide policing services across Scotland.
And you may dismiss them.
And I may dismiss them, yes.
Yeah, which is where one of these...
It's a slightly, yes, it's slightly...
The great plates, as it were, tectonic plates are between you in that...
Yes.
If the HR was, director of HR was with the SPA, well, you're in all the other stuff. It seems to me that's a bit messy.
Can I just say, I think what the Act is intending on a practical basis, and again, I'm not a lawyer, but my view would be if we find... A junior member of police staff, i.e. somebody working in an HR department as an administrator, is abusing other members of staff, it would be gross neglect. I would oversee their dismissal. If the director of HR was guilty of some such thing, then I would not expect to sit down and I would be going to the police authority and saying, we've got a problem here, we've got a senior member of support staff and we need to take action against them. And I would expect the police authority to be involved at that stage. If they were involved in the disciplining of every member of support staff, they would have nothing, well, there'd be nothing else for them to do.
Well. Yeah, I know, but it's direction and control as well, that's the other issue, in that you might not have as many support staff as you want, or too many, because if the SPA were in charge of that, and yet you've got the direction and control, which is, you know, seems to me...
With respect, though, I have direction and control of the 17,500 police officers, and I can't have less than 17,234. So I don't have much leeway there either.
No, I'm sorry, I'm not making my point clearly.
Right.
Maybe somebody else can see where I'm getting with this. Can they, or have I lost everybody?
I'm not sure.
No. The point I'm trying to make is, director of HR, if it goes to the SPA... They decide who's going to be the backroom, the support staff. And then you are chief constable. Who they are subject to your direction of control in the carrying out of their functions. So it seems to me that there's a conflict here, that if the whole thing was in one pot, like yours, it would be tidier.
Yes.
Easier to manage. And I know that's you've already said you want director, HR.
That is clearly my stance, that they should yes. be. But I don't actually think we're very far apart on that.
Okay.
In terms of it's the day-to-day stuff that we're agreed on. I think it's ultimately the sort of corporate lines of command that we may not agree on.
Command that might, at the end of the day, and perhaps under a different chairmanship, could pose a significant problem. If the SPA took a totally different stand in relation to one particular group of support staff, for example, that they just decided they didn't think anybody needed anymore, and yet you felt that to have a balanced workforce and to be able to discharge your functions properly and provide the best police service we want for Scotland, you would be at odds. And yet the authority will have been ceded to the SPA, possibly. So it's not a criticism of any individuals in the posts at the moment. It's looking for possible problems ahead.
I do understand that problem. I'm inclined to say no system of governance is going to be perfect, and exactly what you describe could easily happen under existing legislation in the 8 existing police forces, and will probably happen at some point in the new police service of Scotland. And that's why, with respect to my chair, there are 13 members of the authority, I guess, so that it's not a one-on-one relationship, and that there is room for debate and discussion, and that's the governance structure. To me, that just seems like, that could happen, but it could happen under any governance structure, and it has to be thrashed out between mature individuals trying to do their best.
Emery, do you wish to comment?
No, I think it's pertinent to say that the Act already contemplates the forensic service to be directly reporting to the SPA.
We know that.
That is better than 400 people. Under the agreements we've already agreed on, the ICT organisation will be in the SPA. That's another 450-odd souls. So we're talking a lot of people to be administered by the SPA.
Of course, the counter to your argument is one is mandatory. The forensics is mandatory, so you're in safe territory.
But in principle, it makes no difference.
I don't think it's number of personnel. I think it's the way it functions.
The number of personnel in terms of where a common set of policies and procedures are orchestrated from. And it does not undermine for one second the responsibility of the Chief Constable to have a very senior HR person reporting to him in his command team, looking after all of the souls that report.
Yes, we accept that this is still one of the areas that's quite difficult for you both and has to be negotiated. But I want to take in some of the other members next, Mr. Laing, then I'm going to take Rod and Sandra. You want to come in? Yes.
I'll be very brief. There's very little change in what's being proposed in this Act to what we have at the moment. If we take the example of a unitary authority, Fife, for example, the authority itself is the employer of all non-warranted police officers, but the direction and control is devolved to the Chief Constable who operates that. So the Chief Constable has a Director of HR, Director of Finance, etc. Now, the interesting part about that is there was a significant proposal to amend those arrangements to take those senior support staff and put them within the local authority or back into the council. Probably about 3 years ago, HMI were invited in, Audit Scotland were invited in. There was a significant and fairly public debate. The end outcome was that the status quo was actually the best option, and that direction and control, including of the Director of HR and Director of Finance, who are police staff, it was best rested with the Chief Constable to allow the flexibility to make the operational decisions necessary. So there is history to this, and to some extent it's repeating itself.
That's helpful. Can I, Graham, very quickly, because Rod's been very patient.
It may help Mr. Emery, but back in July, the reform team signed off with civil servants' structure, which indicate that the Director of Finance, Director of Human Resources, Director of Comms Public Affairs all reported through the Chief Constable to the authority. And as explained by Mr. Laing, there's a real rationale there that holds together that might help in future discussions. That's all I wanted to say.
Feel you're giving evidence, Mr. Pearson, there. Rod.
I miss it.
I'll be very brief because most of the points that I would have raised have already been raised. But just to Mr. Laing, in your report earlier on, you said it was critical that the respective roles of the SPA and police service and others were clearly understood. From what I can determine this morning, we're still some way from that point. What do you think you have a role in trying to assist that understanding between your two colleagues with or without legal advice? And, how can you do your job properly after the 1st of April unless there is this clarity?
Our role at this stage is primarily to try and assist with the evidence that we've gathered through the history of policing and policing governance. Almost 2 years ago now, HMI provided a fairly substantial report about governance and accountability in policing, and we set out some clear principles within that. Many of those have been taken forward or incorporated within the Act. We're now working very closely with the Auditor General to discuss what we think are good models of governance and accountability. And so drawing on the 8 best value audits and inspection, drawing on the findings of those and now the overview report, we're able to add some insight as to where we've found best practice, how we think that model of governance could be approached. And we're in dialogue with both Vic and Steve around about some of those aspects. So in the interim period, our role is very much one of encouragement to come to a conclusion on it. But the reality is the devil's in the detail. And until the Chief Constable, the authority and the board are able to look at options, are able to look at that in the context of what has been found previously and come to a conclusion, and we can see where that conclusion lies and what the scheme of delegation involves, i.e. how much will be devolved to the police service, what the scheme of administration is, what the relationships will be like. It's difficult to offer some sort of critical commentary on it. So I guess what I'm saying is, in the meantime, we're there as a source of advice, a source of evidence, and a source of academic evidence. We'll add that into the pot. But once we see what develops, our role next year, post the 1st of April, will be to work very closely with the Auditor General in developing a scheme of inspection and audit, which will then test out how those relationships work. And we are at an advanced stage of those discussions. Part of the Act places a responsibility on me to have an inspection plan in place by the early part of next year. We'll do that in consultation. It will be something that I would hope to be presented to this committee to give you some assurance that we are doing it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Rod. Sandra.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good, good morning, gentlemen. I thought I was coming in this morning and get a wee bit of clarity. Now I think it's even more mixed up, certainly in my mind anyway. I'm trying to get to the actual nub I think we have regarding HR and finance, and I've written down, listening to the evidence and contributions, a dispute is the word that I've written down under HR and finance. Could you please possibly clarify for me, Mr. Emery, you mentioned the fact that some of the act was prescriptive, mandatory, shall, may, etc., etc. But one that you did touch on in particular was the forensic services one. It was absolute. That was absolute to yourself. What other areas, apart from, OK, HR and finance, when that is in the act and it's been seen by everyone and you've accepted that, as far as we can see, or as far as I can see, sorry, it's the only aspect of the act which the SBE has control over. So reading the Act, did something within that Act click your mind to go and get legal advice over finance and HR? Where did you come from in that respect? That, to my reading of the Act, that is the only part of the Act, forensics, which is given over to your responsibility. The rest is up to the Chief Constable. Where did you see within that Act that you were, I don't want to say the word suspicious, but you were concerned that some of the Act should be within the responsibilities of the SBE?
First of all, the forensics is not only the prescriptive bit. The Act clearly says that only the SPA, which is a corporate body, and the Police Service of Scotland is not a corporate body, so only the SPA can buy things. As Steve has already said, he's used an example of cars, where he will present a business case which says, I need four cars to do a specific role, and then someone goes away and buys them from in the SPA. That is quite prescriptive. In terms of why there is an ongoing discussion on finance and HR is because they are key drivers on the governance issue of the whole...
Well, sorry to interrupt. Yeah, absolutely, and I think that's why we're here today,
yes,
to get some clarification on it. You mentioned corporate, you know, et cetera, which is not words I would use regarding the police, and I think the public out there wouldn't see it as a corporate entity. They see it as a service designed to protect and serve them. What I'm trying to get at is the finance and HR, this is a sticking point. We still haven't resolved it. Where, in your mind, did you see you needed legal advice and the Act was not prescriptive, mandatory, may, shall, whatever it may be, regarding human resources and finance?
My legal advice was not simply directed at the finance and the HR, and I don't want you to think that that's the sole purpose of it. My legal advice was to ensure that the other 12 members of the board knew exactly what the Act was asking them to do, what liabilities and responsibilities they were taking on. It is the first port of call. If you go into a corporate organisation, you look at their articles of association. What are we here to do?
So
and therefore the Act describes that, and we need to understand the limits of what that allows the board to take responsibility of.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that clarification.
I think it's section 3.1b you'd be referring to, about the part where it's the authority may provide and maintain anything necessary or desirable for the carrying out police functions. And then there's a list, including vehicles, equipment, information, technology, lands, buildings and other structures. Mm. That's the sort of discretionary part.
Yeah. That part is discretionary, yes. But I think your question, Sandra, was about finance and HR.
Well, I think the nub of the whole situation is finance and, you know, human resources. That is the finite talking point, sticking point, etc., as it may be. But, and I thank you for what you had said, you constantly mention corporate body. Obviously, that's the language you use, but certainly not the language that I would use when I'm talking about the police force. So I'll leave that aside. I'll rest it aside at the moment. And I could maybe open up to others as well. When you're talking about operational matters, and I think Alison, my colleague Alison, had actually got to the nub of this as well. If you're in charge of a police force, as Alison said, and you're wishing to have, you know, extra people put in certain places, surely that should be the responsibility of the chief constable who has operational responsibility. And then you're talking, that's the human resource part. And then you're talking about the finance part. And I noted that you said, Mr. Emery, when we were questioned, I think it was your opening remarks, you mentioned that HR and finance is best left until agreement with the chief constable to exactly what finances are required. I noted that that was a language used, best left until agreement, not agreement between the two, until agreement with the chief constable. And then you mentioned the budget belongs to the SPA. That was some of the language you used also. Wouldn't you agree that if you're in the forefront of the operational management of the police, then you should have, or you must then, I'll use that word, must have some input into how many police officers are put on the beat or wherever they may be, and the finances to be able to carry out that operation?
I think we've covered this morning already the fact that there's no dispute about that.
Well, I hate to dispute you, but I think there is a dispute. I mean, it's all about, and I don't want to go back, and I know that people have been very, very nice about it and saying you're talking about it, you're having a meeting, come back on the 5th of December, which is only a couple of days away. It's a very important act, this, and it'll be coming in April to the Parliament. And I think it's fine for people to say we're working it out between us, but I think this committee, you know, basically has a right to know exactly what is going on. I certainly don't feel comfortable or comforted by the evidence that I've heard tonight. I still think there is this dispute between yourselves and the Chief Constable in regards to the finance and the human resources, which is the most important part. And certainly what I've heard here today doesn't give me comfort, I must admit.
Well, there is no dispute between the Chief Constable can speak for himself, but there is no dispute between us on who controls policing. And the Chief Constable does that. We agree an organisation structure. We agree a budget. He has 17,234 police and a considerable number of police staff who become police staff when they're allocated to the Chief Constable as a result of the discussions that we're having to perform tasks. There will be less of them in the future than there are now because there is a reform programme which mm-hmm. takes some of them out. We are trying to do that on a voluntary basis so that there is no harm to anyone. But once they are within the Police Service of Scotland, they are under the control and direction of the Chief Constable, and he can do with them whatever he needs to do to satisfy the safe policing of Scotland.
Chair, thank you.
I'm sorry if I've sort of sounded complacent up till now about, you know, we're having a debate and it's a sensible debate. I mean, I haven't meant to sound complacent. I understand it does cause some concern. I certainly think it's important, and I'm grateful for the committee spending the time looking at it. We are down to the differences of opinion around control around HR and finance. And I go back to more or less where I started. The level of debate we're now having is, okay, well, where will the Director of Finance actually have his or her office? Where will the Director of HR actually work from? Will they be reporting to the Chief Constable on a daily basis, or will they be actually working in the SPA headquarters building away from the Chief Constable's headquarters? The answer is very clear, and I think it's been repeated several times here, that the Director of HR and Finance will work with next to the Chief Constable on my senior management team on a daily basis, and that I will be responsible on a daily basis for direction and control, and we will also be developing forward-looking strategy on HR and Finance, but we would expect completely to discuss that forward-looking strategy with the authority and do that in the form that we've done in the past in the main, which is to prepare a business case, take papers for the consideration. I think the change here will be that the authority will be far more proactive and far more demanding in its scrutiny because it is the authority's budget given to it by the taxpayer. To me, all that sounds relatively healthy, and if that is how it is thrashed out and appears, not in writing, because actually that's not the point. What matters is how does it actually work in practice. Then I'm content that gives me the flexibility I need to direct and control the police service on a daily basis. And of course there will be tensions and rubs with the authority. I was Chief Constable of Strathclyde for 5 years. We had tensions and rubs all the time on different things. But all in all, despite sometimes what Audit Scotland and the HMI thought, I think we did a pretty good job together. And I think most chief constable would say the same across the board. There's always going to be issues and problems. Again, I'm not being complacent. I'm not saying problem solved and fixed. I hope we don't have to come back again in front of yourselves to say, oh, well, we're still thrashing this out in a few weeks' time. I wouldn't want to do that. I think there's a time for debate and there's a time for getting on with it, and we're at the time for getting on with it. But the timescale, as the Chair has clearly said, is the 5th of December is the authority meeting at which they will consider the governance arrangements, and I'm hoping we'll agree pretty much with what we've laid out here this morning.
Can I ask why you're at two different locations, the SPA and...
I think it is necessary. I think I sort of stuck my oar in fairly early on and suggested that should be the case, because that the public has to understand there is a clear distinction and definition between the two bodies, whether the police service is a corporate body or not, I don't know, but it's a police service, and there's a police authority overseeing the police service.
It's perception, really.
It's perception. It may actually be motorway miles between the two are a pain in the neck because there is constant meeting of staff, etc.
That's what I meant.
But actually, I think the perception is an important one in terms of one another not being in each other's pockets.
I see you nodding, but I mean, I know large legal firms where one partner will act for one side of a contract and another partner will act for the other side of a contract, and there are walls between them, real yeah. and metaphorical walls. And it does seem, I take your, I understand why you're doing it, but it does seem that you're duplicating.
If I may just come back on that, Chair, I mean, a lot of the debate this morning has been about Chief Constable, can you assure us that you have operational control of the police service
yes.
and that this man here is not telling you what to do?
Yes.
Well, if we were working in adjacent offices, then I think there would be a huge degree of, well, hang on, they may not be telling him what to do, but you might be very cosy in your relationship. It's not meant to be a cosy relationship.
Think that for 1 minute.
It's meant to be slightly arm's length, and I think the fact that you are in separate buildings is probably politically the right thing to do.
Okay, I wasn't going to place you cheek by jowl. It could have been separate large ends of a building with a big corridor in between, but there we are. It's not going to happen. So, Alison, then Jenny, please.
Thank you. A couple of questions, if I may, Convener. The audit report, which was I referred to earlier, noted that across all of our audits and inspections, we consistently found that police authorities do not provide strategic leadership on equality and diversity issues. And it goes on to recommend that training programmes for members of the SPA and those involved in agreeing local policing plans should include an appropriate level of training on equalities duties. I would be interested to hear from the panel of what arrangements have been put in place and what priority you're giving to that particular issue.
Well, if I start off by saying, I do think what the report says, it's the police authorities that were not the police forces individually, and it certainly won't be the Police Service of Scotland's position either. We will have equality and diversity shot through all our strategies.
Yeah.
The service hasn't been involved in the selection, quite obviously, of the police authority, and I really think that's probably something that the Chair may wish to address rather than myself. But we would stand ready to provide training around equality and diversity to any members of the authority or indeed their staff, which actually is just as important as anything that they would need.
Well, at the moment, the board has not met to even agree the standing orders, and therefore this is a piece of business that needs to be transacted. As soon as we get an HR organisation in place, we can get all of those policies put in place. As a ethos, we agree absolutely with the diversity agenda. And if you look at the board of the SPA, you will see that that is more than adequately demonstrated at board level.
So you're making appointments as we speak. You made appointments yesterday without an equalities and diversity policy or statement?
We have no internal policy written yet because we're only a month old. Mm-hmm. But both Chief Constable and myself sat on the interview panel and diversity was a part of our agenda in the interview.
Okay, and I'm trying to establish how important you see it as the board moves forward. Will it be one of the first papers you bring to the board, or
Yes, it will be one of the early papers. I wouldn't say it will be the first paper, but it will be an early paper. I am committed to diversity. I've worked all the way around the world, so I am committed to diversity.
Maybe just pick up on a couple of points. The best value overview report, in essence, what we found was that the commitment to equalities and diversity within policing per se was good. Yeah. Within authorities, there are two functions. First of all, the authority has to provide a strategic oversight of what the police are doing, and we found that that was largely passive. Mm-hmm. But the second part is the authority in its own right has a responsibility to equalities and diversity, mm-hmm. and that was not being picked up, it was not being adhered to. And just a final point on that, in relation to the recent appointment process, in addition to both Vic and Steve being on the panel, I sat as independent advisor to ensure that all those bits were being covered. And I guess in terms of time, it would be unreasonable to ask the authority to have those policies in place.
Well, that's reassuring that that independent voice was at the table. And on a totally separate question, it would be interesting to hear an update on your regional plans and how you see the operational structure of the police coming forward. We've obviously heard reports in newspapers and things. It would be useful to hear here.
Chair, I'm happy to talk that through. As you will all know, policing is an inherently hierarchical organisation, and we love designing organisational charts. So the Chief Constable is in place. We now have four deputies in place. We are currently, as the Chair said, in the middle of early selection and sifting for the seven ACCs, our Assistant Chief Constables, who will be in place. I've already met, and we've done a lot of planning on this over the last 12 months. The situation will be there will be three territorial assistant chief constables, one covering the north of the country, one covering the west, one covering the east. Reporting to them will be 14 divisional commanders, and they are effectively already in place because a number of forces, as you will probably know from your representation around the country, have already moved in this direction. So Tayside Police has moved to a single territorial division for the whole organisation, as has Fife, as has Central, as has Northern. And we're building on that structure in an attempt to not in any way upset or alarm particularly our local council partners and the chief execs and the leaders of those councils. We're trying to keep that to an absolute minimum. So we are identifying, as I'm obliged to do under the law, I'm obliged to identify designated local police commanders. And I'm obliged also to consult with the local authority as to the identity of that individual. I've already written to the vast majority of councils in Scotland identifying somebody as the local police commander, and it is, without exception, the person who's currently in place. Letters are now starting to come back from the councils saying, yes, they're very happy with that nomination, with the odd query, and one or two councils saying, do we really have to be united in one division? Why can't we stand on our own as a police division? And we're meeting with them and trying to talk them through that. And so far, successfully, I think we've resolved concerns on that. That allows us, with the divisional commanders identified, to make sure that they have the sort of mandate under the new Act to go ahead with the discussions with the local councils and other local partners to create the 32 local policing plans that we're required to create by law for the 1st of April. In the same timescale, we obviously have to have consultation on the government's four strategic priorities, and that consultation is underway at the moment. And the authority will then create a three-year strategic policing plan. I will develop an annual policing plan, and it all has to fit together. But frankly, to give the 32 councils and the local commanders a heads up on this and give them some lead time, we're sort of saying to them, get on and start talking locally now to develop the local plans, because they are inherently local plans. And although they will be informed by strategic directives, etc., actually it's about the locality. If they're not relevant to the local area, then they're not relevant. So we want them to get on and start doing, and they are doing that, and they're at various stages of developing those 32 local policing plans. Underneath that, I've given some instructions that I want. There's 353 wards, council ward areas across Scotland, and I want each ward to have its own policing plan up and running for the 1st of April, which, in effect, will be even more local, and will really concentrate on the top three concerns that the public have in each of the ward areas that they live in, and therefore what the police are going to do about that over the next 12 months. So that's how the structure's developing at the moment. I have to say, you know, we're moving forward with it because we have to, because here we are approaching December. It's got to be up and running for the 1st of April. I can't have officers not knowing what is the direction of travel, what are they expected to focus on, and what are we measuring them on. So we need that in place ASAP.
Mm-hmm. There may be an issue about where the various headquarters would be. Is that part of the...
There will only be one police headquarters, Chair.
Yes.
And yes, there will be a debate about that. The interim headquarters is at Tully Allen. I think the jury is out as whether or not that is operationally the right place to have a headquarters, but there's no alternative identified. We're not doing any work on that at the moment. But there will only be one headquarters. The fact that I talked about an assistant chief constable in the West, they will cover the West, but they will work from headquarters. The East will cover the East, but they will work from headquarters. The exception will be the Northern ACC, who I think simply through distance and geography will have to spend a fair degree of their time in the north of the country. But I would still expect them, either through video link or in person, to come to most of our major meetings. But we need to have them on the ground.
So there would be these three other... I think that's been raised with me about, you know...
Yeah, I mean, I think that's probably... We all live and learn on communications. I've spoken about the three regions, and I think, as I said, police are madly into hierarchy, and we'll build structures. So the easiest thing to do is say, oh, well, there'll be an ACC West, so he or she will need their own headquarters. But we're not going to have their own headquarters.
Right.
There will be one headquarters, and we will all work there alongside the Director of HR and Finance.
Thank you for that clarification. I now move on. Jenny, followed by David.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to clarify something that came up earlier. Mr. Emery, I was interested in Sandra White's first question, but I don't think we got a clear answer to that. Can I ask why you sought legal advice on whether you had jurisdiction over HR and finance, if the Act was quite clear that they came under the Chief Constable's control?
Well, I think I already answered that. I did not seek legal advice with regard to HR and finance. I got legal advice on the interpretation of the Act. What does the Act empower the 12 members plus myself of the board to do? So it wasn't concentrated on HR and finance. Clearly, the SPA is responsible for the complete budget, every last penny of it.
Okay.
And so, therefore, they have an obligation to ensure best value.
Okay, so your legal advice doesn't include advice on whether you have jurisdiction over HR and finance?
It's advice on the Act, yeah. And the Act says in various places that some things are prescriptive and some things are permissive.
Thank you.
I feel I've gone round in a dizzy circle with that, but we'll see the legal advice anyway, and then we may have to take legal advice on the legal advice, who knows. David.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I was just wondering if you could update us on where we are in relation to the proposed reductions in the numbers of police staff.
I'm happy to start off on that. We are, I hope, very near agreeing, and that doesn't imply any dispute at all, simply working through the process of designing it, a voluntary redundancy and early retirement package, which we hope to get out in the next few weeks. But that, again, has to go to the authorities meeting on the 5th of December to be agreed quite clearly, and that would be entirely appropriate. Once that is available, we are pretty well advanced in designing the proposed structures and staffing numbers of civilian support staff across the service. So we have plans showing how many people we would want within HR, within finance, within our vehicle workshops, etc. What we still have to discuss to a degree is, well, where will some of these units be based? What will the locations be? And because we've not finalised that, we're not ready yet to go to the workforce and to the unions to say this is exactly what we have in mind. And clearly we have to enter negotiations. Well, we believe we'd enter negotiations, but we have to get into really detailed discussions with the unions and the various representative bodies around this is what we're proposing, what do you think? Because quite clearly they have a valid opinion to come back and say, well, let's challenge that situation, let's challenge that. We think there's a better way of doing this. And we have to ask the staff themselves, can you see a better way of redesigning this? All that is in train. All eight police forces and the SPSA are experienced in running these processes, and I hope we will take the best experience we've had of those and run a fully engaged and open process, which will allow a number of staff to leave the service under voluntary redundancy, I hope ahead of April the 1st, because the earlier we can move people out voluntarily, the quicker we can restructure the organisation and we'll start to make some real savings, and that we need to do that to hit our budget for 2013-14.
Thank you. Mr. Emery, do you?
No, I agree. There is a number of reform projects to do things more efficiently. That's been going on for the last 12 months. There are a number of different VR options that we're going to be talking about. In fact, Steve and I are meeting yet again this afternoon to go through some of that stuff to present to the SPA board on the 5th of December so that we can move forward. I think Steve's point is absolutely correct, which is we need to get a full year effect as much as possible, and therefore we need to move rapidly on a VR arrangement.
And can you just clarify for me what do you anticipate to be over the next three financial years the reduction in the number of police staff?
I think that it's very premature to project that. We are hoping that quite a few people will seek to look for alternatives to their current employment before the 1st of April. Over the next 2-3 years, there'll be a number of different twists and turns in the road ahead, and I think it will be premature to project or speculate on how many people might be affected.
Thank you, Dave. This has to be very brief, because we're all tiring.
In the context of staffing and the plan for the future, in slimming down the executive, the ACPOS members, it's quite evident that there will be a substantial number of current posts will go by the wayside. Is there a plan to deal with these executive posts, and is there anything you can share with us just now about where we stand in the next 12 months? Because these are a large posts and a heavy draw in finance.
It's a difficult area.
I'm glad I brought it up.
Yeah. I mean, we are right in the middle of this. I mean, we only appointed deputies on Friday, announced publicly on yesterday, in fact. So we're only starting to now identify there are some individuals in key leadership posts at the moment performing a day job now, who after the 1st of April there won't be a formal place for within the organisation. So it's highly personalised to a small number of people at this moment in time. That number will increase in the next month, because we will then be placing ACCs, and we have 15 or 16 applicants for the posts. There are 7 posts. The vast majority of applicants are internal Scottish applicants in the Scottish system at the moment. Therefore, there will be some displacement there, a greater number of displacement. There's no doubt in the business of reform there will be a need for extra work streams to be carried out. That will be, frankly, I think, for myself and for the authority to sit down with the Director of HR and Director of Finance and work out, is there an exit package, an exit strategy for these individuals? For example, I would be suggesting that individual A has 6 months to go before they reach a pensionable retirement date. There is little point in pursuing a section in the Act which does exist to exit that person from the organisation when in 6 months' time, actually, they'll be going anyway. I think that would be the appropriate thing to do. If someone, on the other hand, has 18 months or 2 years or a lot longer to wait, then there has to be an understanding that the public is going to get benefit from continued employment of that individual. I do believe that is going to be eminently provable for a number of key people for the first little while in the organisation. I mean, I would say to members that we are going from a situation of 8 chiefs, 8 deputies, and just under 20 ACCs to 1 chief, 4 deputies, and 7 ACCs, and one of the deputies and one of the ACCs is specifically on the Commonwealth Games and other major sporting events. So they may, in a time, that may reduce again. It's a significant reduction in senior management, That's my view, and I have to caveat that the authority needs to see these proposals, but that's what we're interviewing against, and I think time has pushed us to go ahead and do that, and I'm grateful to the Chair for doing that, because frankly, if we'd had to wait until December to go ahead and advertise any of these posts, we'd be in trouble by now.
So there's a bit of thought being given to it.
There's thought being given to it, balancing the need to treat individuals with respect,
indeed,
but also to treat public money with respect.
Thank you.
Now, because she said a harmonious note there, which I think would be really nice to finish on, I know Rod and Alison won't back in again, but what I'm going to say is to the committee, we can have everyone back after the 5th of December, subject to their commitments, and have further questioning if necessary. By that time, we'll have seen the legal advice. We may have taken our own legal advice. Who knows? But I think we'll have every opportunity. And we have had an hour and 40 minutes, I think, a fair crack at it. And I noticed you were calling each other Vic, Steve and Andrew at the end of it. So there must be something happening in the chemistry in the Justice Committee. We can only hope you come to a reasonable agreement at the end about... I hate to say it, but Director of Finance and Director of HR in the interests of the Scottish public. Thank you very much for your evidence. Thank you. I'm going to suspend for just 1 minute. Just stay put, though, committee, because I want to move to the next item before we have a proper break. I'm going to move immediately on. We're back online again. Item three. If your attention, please, members, just very quickly. Subordinate legislation, 5 negative instruments for us to consider, all relate to fees. The Subordinate Legislation Committee has identified and drawn our attention to drafting errors in 4 of the instruments. Now, the reason why they're in front of us is because of certain drafting areas. You may wish to make a comment on that. The first is the Adults with Incapacity Public Guardian Fees, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2012, SSI 2012-289, contains 2 minor drafting errors. The Scottish Government has acknowledged the errors but has confirmed that it does not intend to amend the instrument as the errors have no legal effect. Isn't that nice to know? Court of Session, etc. Fees Amendment Order 2012, SSI 2012-290, the High Court of Justiciary Fees Amendment Order 2012, SSI 2012-291, the Sheriff Court's Fees Amendment Order 2012, SSI 2012-293 were all drawn to our attention on the basis of defective drafting. The government has undertaken to lay amending orders to correct these errors before they come into effect. And the final instrument is the Justices of Peace Court Fees Scotland Order 2012, SSI 2012-292, which has not been drawn to our attention by the Subordinate Legislation Committee. Do you have any comments with regard to these instruments?
Yes, I do.
Yes, Jenny.
I may be wrong on this. It's my understanding that these have been drawn to our attention not just because of the drafting errors, but they would have had to come to the committee anyway, as we're the lead committee on these SSIs. And it's the SSIs as a whole that I want to put on the record that I feel that at this time of recession and with the welfare reform going through Westminster, these large fee increases in our courts are particularly problematic. At a time of welfare reform, they make litigation for people on low and limited incomes much more difficult. And as the welfare reforms progress through Westminster, it is likely that there will be more litigation, potentially people looking to take their cases to court. I also wanted an opportunity, and I don't know, maybe the clerks can tell me if we get an opportunity to ask the Cabinet Secretary or the Minister if they will be considering increasing the threshold from £6 to £8 in light of the fees. This doesn't seem to match up to me. So, and also on the point of full cost recovery, I think it's a point for a committee that we have to ask ourselves if full cost recovery in our civil courts is actually what the committee thinks is a good idea to pursue, given that the courts are a public service, and especially, as I say, in this time of recession and increased difficulty with welfare reform, if we want to pursue an agenda of full cost recovery in the civil courts.
Can I just check? I don't think it's full cost recovery. I may be wrong about that, but...
Convener, I have sympathy with what Jenny has said there. And in particular, in the concluding statements of these, where
in relation to the question of a quality impact assessment, we've been told they'll be published shortly. Now, perhaps I should have checked to see if they are online, but that would certainly inform issues around the matters raised quite properly by Jenny, I think.
I think, I'm just correcting it, full cost recovery isn't cost of court expenses, it's the cost of the process. I may be wrong in this, Rod, if you perhaps help me out here. Full cost of process would be simply the laying of various papers towards court, the fees chargeable for that. Is that correct? It's court fees and fees for services offered by the Court of Session.
I'm not certain that
it's not judicial costs. Yeah. It's not judicial costs.
I know,
costs.
But of the process, yeah.
I think what we're talking about is outlays that people have to put in to put petitions in and summons.
Has
and
that been
writs.
Subject to kind of some discussion in recent times about the general principle of that?
I think Lord Gill discussed it as well. I mean,
I appreciate that.
Mm. Would the committee be happy for us to get more information with regard to this against the background of the costs, welfare reform? With regard to the £68 threshold, I thought I heard the Cabinet Secretary saying that he was in discussions about that. And I don't think we're anywhere near stage three. When stage three of the civil... So there's no date for that, so we've got time to find out how that might resolve itself.
I think he was in discussions on the criminal threshold.
That's correct.
£68, but I never heard him clarify that he was also looking to raise the civil threshold.
Yes, he
was
did. He said if he does that, he will raise the civil threshold as well, definitely. Okay. So, Rod.
Could I just ask for clarification in terms of the business inequalities assessments? I'm not sure. Is that proper to say that they will be published shortly?
Sorry, what are you referring to? Which one?
The impact assessments and inequalities, because we're basically considering things and then you don't have the opportunity of actually looking at the assessment.
Well, what should we do?
Is just as a matter of procedure, is that permissible to do it?
So, but what would we do? Can we defer our view in these?
Can we take evidence from the Cabinet?
Well, I think we'd rather write to them in the first instance than take evidence, but frankly, we can look at it next week again if you wished, and in the meantime, the questions that have been raised by members can be put to the Cabinet Secretary. Put your questions to the clerks and we'll draft a letter to the Cabinet Secretary of the answers before we next consider it. Are you satisfied if we do that?
Yes.
I also, frankly, there was another thing I want to raise, which is the number of times we find that we have to, I'll not be happy with saying this, but the number of times amending orders have to be laid to correct matters before they come into effect. We always seem to be seeing this. Shall we ask, you know, just what's come before this committee, how often have we had to get this in front of us with amending orders, let alone the substance of an SI?
Can I also say, Convener, it may be an error, but it's also slightly misleading when we're preparing, thinking that these SSIs are coming before us because there has been a drafting error where actually we need to consider the substance
of
them.
No, I've said
it
already.
Well.
That was my mistake. That was my mistake at the beginning. I've already corrected that. Sandra.
Chair, I think we've all got to Cabinet Secretary's letter, which came with the papers, and it basically says, willing to put forward an amendment to increase the financial threshold, but this must be across civil and criminal.
Yeah. So he's also said in public an interview, so I was aware of that. Right, we're going to raise those things, and we're going to come back to this next week. We are now moving into private session.